So let's get a legal mind now. In studio, we have Mudhomithi and Kolu, he's a lawyer. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us this afternoon. It's been a very hectic day, crazy. What are your thoughts about that particular statement by IEBC Chair Wafula Chebukati? You were here when he was giving it.
Yes, leader. For me, the question that arises is how did we as a country find ourselves in this situation Chebukati is describing? And why is he talking about this in the very dying moments of the electoral process when it is clear that the political class, and by this I mean both sides of Jubilee and NASA, if you've observed events happening at the IBC for close to 3 years now, up to even the point when Isaac Hassan Commission was in place, there have been battles, some of them in the law courts, some of them on the streets, by both sides to control the IBC. So for me, the question that arises is, why has the IBC chairman discovered a week to the election that his commission has been infiltrated? Isn't this statement he's making today, isn't it the statement he ought to have made on the day he assumed office and then taken steps to ensure we are not now in the situation that we are in?
True. He's making this 8 days to the election, but you also realize at the time he also wrote a memo just outlining some of the issues they may have within the IBC Commission and ways in which he thought maybe this could be fixed.
For me, the question really that arises, if the chairman of the electoral management body can come on national television a week to the election and he says to the nation, I cannot guarantee, given the prevailing circumstances, that we can have a free, fair, and credible election, then the question that arises for me as a lawyer is then, why are we having that election in the first place? I know there are all these debates that this election must be held within 60 days to comply with the Constitution, to comply with the court order, but that narrative is not actually entirely correct, even from a legal point of view. If there are genuine reasons why the Commission cannot hold a free, credible election in the next 7 days, then the discussion should be what should be done within the law about that problem. And for me, the advice I would give Chebukati, because his commission always appears impervious to good legal advice, is if you cannot guarantee by your own words that you can hold a free, credible and fair election, then the solution is simple. Go back to the Supreme Court, tell them that I have encountered the following difficulties, including the infiltration and the boardroom fights he's alluding to. And therefore, judges, I'm asking you to extend this timeline to maybe a next date when I hope that I will have put the IBC in order, will have taken proper steps to do an election. From where I sit as a lawyer, there is absolutely no point going into this election, because everyone who has eyes and ears, you actually don't need to have a brain to know that this election...
There's a problem with this election.
As not just a problem, but fundamental problems.
Okay,
he's already saying he's meeting candidates, including one who has already disowned and walked out of the process. So my plea to Chebukati is that the situation you're in, fine, we can talk until thy kingdom come as to how you found yourself there, but the proper thing to do is go back to the Supreme Court, tell them, my ladies and my lords, I know you ordered me to conduct an election
within
in
60
days,
and I cannot.
The law is not such an ass as to insist that something must be done, even if the conditions is that it cannot be done properly.
Okay, listening into Chebukati and the reasons that he's giving, of course, pointing now to the fact that he's having issues even with the commissioners and the political interference, are those reasons enough to not have this election on 26th of October? Are those reasons that he can present before the Supreme Court and say, hey, I'm having interference, I cannot work with my commissioners, I don't think we are able to have this election on time? And as a lawyer, which is better? Because like you rightly put it, we're having a conversation where people say, we absolutely must have this election on 26th. The others are saying, do we want an election on 26th that is going to be annulled again because Maraga was very categorical? If such a case makes its way to the Supreme Court, we'll nullify it again. So do we want to postpone this as a country legally? Which would be the best option? Postpone it and basically get a different date where you can have a free, fair, credible election, or go through this one that everyone, some quarters are insisting on, and then probably get it annulled?
No, there is no point going into an election that has been disowned by, technically speaking, half of the country. I mean, Raila had 6 million votes, Uhuru had 8 million. So they are more like split, almost 50-50. There is no point in holding such an election in the circumstances that
we're... Okay, so legally, A, there's no point in holding this election.
Yes.
B.
And just to answer your specific question, are these things alluded to in Chebukati's statement, things that would persuade the court to actually shift the date of this election? From what I see, there is no reason why the court shouldn't, as long as you're able to be honest with the court and tell the court this is the prevailing situation. Any judge or magistrate properly directing their mind to the situation now prevailing in the country should see that the courts themselves, actually our Supreme Court, as a doctrine they call a doctrine of necessity. And it simply means unique situations call for unique judicial interventions. So as a strictly legal question, yes, even these problems Chebukati has, if properly packaged before the court properly directing its mind to the problem could actually give him time and extend the date.
Okay, so just listening into some of the reasons he's giving, clearly this is a man who is quote-unquote under siege. So what are the options legally? Because there's been that fear that if Kenya does not have an election in 60 days, there could be a constitutional crisis. And trust me, I've spoken to very many legal minds. People cannot agree on the consequences. So you're saying Wafula Chebukati has the option of going back to the Supreme Court and asking them to allow him to do this election, to have this election on a different date, apart, away from the 60 days. What are the legal consequences of this?
Of course, if you don't hold this election, and that's why the court intervention is necessary, you leave too many things without a firm legal foundation. Number one, our president is currently exercising an office called temporary incumbency. Mm. If you don't hold this election, then the question that arises immediately on 1st November is that office vacant or is the temporary incumbency extended until we hold the election? Can that temporary incumbency itself be held in perpetuity? Remember, these are problems that have been caused by the political class. So no one wants the uncertainties that come from not holding the election. And that's why I'm saying to avoid those uncertainties, the player should go back to the court and tell the court, these are the likely scenarios to happen if we don't hold the election. These are the likely scenarios to happen if we hold an election that has already been disowned by one of the main players. And therefore, in the circumstances, we are seeking, first of all, you give us an extension of time.
Okay.
We are seeking that if it's about the temporary incumbency, you also extend it by the X number of days. And the truth is, the court has all those powers, whether strictly speaking or as a matter of inherent judicial power. So I'm one of those who don't believe that we are in this unfortunate situation where there is no way forward. And for me, the way forward is to actually go and plead the situation before the court.
Okay, so I'm going to put you a little bit on the spot. I remember there have been some legal minds that are saying I think, is it November 1st? The president ceases to have the powers that he currently has.
Yes.
Is that the case? Can the Supreme Court fix this? Which way do we go?
You see, the problem with legal questions, Linda, is I was telling some people the other week, the law, just like you can find in the Bible something that justifies a clause that justifies and a clause
that
condemns.
Yeah, you're told don't
condemns.
Read this one.
You know, you're told don't commit murder, then you read the Old Testament, you can kill some tribes. Some people tell you can't marry two wives. Another one tells you King Solomon had 700 wives and whatnot. So for me, the advice I would give is we avoid this very legalistic, technical discussion and ask ourselves, since the matter at hand threatens the very existence of our country, what should be done? We all agree we are in a very unfortunate situation. And to answer your question, there are several answers. whether the temporary incumbency would expire, whether the office of president would be now vacant, whether the speaker should now assume that office in an acting capacity.
So in other words,
clever arguments on various perspectives on all those questions. But for me, that's not where the solution lies.
Where's the solution?
The solution lies in what I told you earlier. Tell the court, sorry, we're in a position where we can't hold the election, at least not on 26, and therefore we need the court intervention because it's the only institution, as we speak, that can diffuse all these tensions, give us a new timetable where we'll do this election. If it's about the question of the presidency and what happens to it, that question can also be explained by the court, and the court can intervene and say, fine, he can remain in office up to X date, or the speaker can take over up to X date. I mean, the courts can have powers to extend all those things.
Okay.
So that for me, the narrative that will be in this bottomless black hole of a constitutional crisis is just scaremongering and lazy.
You know, you're a legal mind, so you understand it. Millions of Kenyans out there don't understand it. They're like, okay, what's going to happen to this country?